الصبح بان من طلعته والليل من وفاته فقر الرسل فضلا وعلا أهدى السبل لدلالته الصبح بدا من طلعته والليل دجى من وفرته فقر الرسل فضلا وعلا أهدى السبل لدلالته كنز الكرم مولى النعم هدي الأمم لشريعته أزكى النسب أعلى الحسب كل العرب في خدمته كل العرب في خدمته الصبح بدا من طلعته والليل دجى من وفرته فقر الرسل فضلا وعلا أهدى السبل لدلالته سعتي الشجر نطق الحجر شق القمر بإشارته جبريل أتى ليلة سرى والرب دعا لحضرته والرب دعا لحضرته الصبح بدا والليل دجى من وفرته فقر الرسل فضلا وعلا أهدى السبل لدلالته نال الشرف والله عفا عما سلف من أمته فمحمدنا هو سيدنا فالعز لنا لإجابته فالعز لنا لإجابته الصبح بدا من طلعته والليل دجى من وفرته فقر الرسل فضلا وعلا أهدى السبل لدلالته الصبح بدا من طلعته والليل دجى من وفرته فقر الرسل فضلا وعلا أهدى السبل لدلالته أهدى السبل لدلالته.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه الطاهرين ما دام ما في السماوات والأرضين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم إنا نسألك علما ينفعنا وارفعنا اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا ورزقا واسعا وعملا متقبلا وشفاء من كل داء وبعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته الحمد لله all thanks and praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is many blessings that he has bestowed upon us وإن تعدوا نعمة الله لا تحصوها if you endeavor to count the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala you will not be able to do so One such blessing is the fact that we are gathered in a gathering to recite Quran, not only to recite Quran, but to study Quran. It's a narration that we quote quite often when we find ourselves in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam says, مَجْتَمَعَ قَوْمٌ فِي بَيْتٍ مِنْ بُيُوتِ اللَّهِ يَتْلُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَيَتَدَارَسُونَهُ فِي مَا بَيْنَهُمْ. That no people gather in a house of the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for what purpose are they gathering? They are gathering in order to recite the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not only to recite the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but to study the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What benefits accrue to such persons? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam says, نَزَلْتَ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّكِينَةِ. Peace and tranquility descends upon them. غَشِيَتْهُمُ الرَّحْمَةِ. That they are covered with the mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَحَفَّتُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ, and the angels surround such a gathering. Though we do not find ourselves in a house of the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have been barred from congregational prayers, from congregation for religious purposes. But because we have gathered every Sunday in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when circumstances don't allow us to gather, our hope from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that He grant us the same reward as if we are in a house of the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah accept and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect each and every one of us, his and near her, near and dear ones, from this pandemic, the coronavirus, COVID-19. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us. May Allah protect our near and dear ones. Amin ya Rabbal Alameen. Today, inshallah, we're going to be starting a new chapter of the Quran. And the chapter that we are starting with today is referred to as Suratul Qamar. We have a particular methodology, we have a particular approach when starting a new chapter. The first is that in Arabic, a chapter is referred to as surah. The word surah literally refers to a haw. And in the Arabic language, there are two words that denote, that indicate to haw. The one word is jidarun. Jidarun refers to a haw, but a low haw. And the word surah also refers to a haw, but a high haw. So the reason why a surah is referred to as a surah is because it contains high and lofty meanings. So that's the first step. Second step is we focus on the name of a surah, the name of the surah. Certain surah, certain chapters have one name. Other chapters have multiple names. There is a distinction between the name of a given chapter and the theme of the chapter. So here we're not focusing on the theme of the chapter, we are focusing on the name of the chapter. The name of this particular chapter, in certain narrations, as it occurs in certain of the narrations, that أن رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يقرأ بقاف وقتربت الساعة في الفطر والأضحى. That on the occasion of Eid al-Adha and Eid al-Fitr, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to recite two chapters. The one chapter is known as Surah Al-Qaf, and the other chapter was known as Surah Iqtarabat al-Sa'ah. So from this particular narration, we get the name of the surah. One of the names of the surah is referred to as Surah Iqtarabat al-Sa'ah. Another name simply takes the name of this particular chapter from the very first word. This chapter, in the very first verse, as we shall see in a moment, starts with the word iqtarabat. So some refer to it as Surah Iqtarabat, using the first word. But the more famous name for this particular chapter, as you can clearly see from the slides, would refer to as Surah Al-Qamar. It is known as the Surah of Al-Qamar. And Qamar in the Arabic language refers to the moon. And we will speak a bit about that particular miraculous event which took place so many years ago. So the first thing we discussed on this beautiful Sunday is that the name of this particular chapter is three. Surah Iqtarabat al-Sa'ah, Surah Iqtarabat, or Surah al-Qamar. The next issue is that when we look at chapters in the Holy Quran, they divide it into two. The first is referred to as Suwar Makkiyah, and the second is referred to as Suwar Madaniyah. So in other words, you have Makki chapters and you have Madani chapters. It doesn't refer to a certain place wherein the chapter was revealed, but rather certain timelines. So those chapters which were revealed prior to the immigration of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam from Mecca to Medina, those are referred to as Makki chapters. Those that were revealed after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had migrated from Mecca to Medina, those are referred to as Madani chapters. The chapter that we are going to be dealing with in this particular segment is a chapter which was revealed not in Mecca. I'm going to be making the same mistake, but rather it is referred to as a Makki surah. In other words, it was revealed prior to the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So those are the first two things. The second thing would be the cause of revelation. That's the third thing we're going to be discussing by way of introduction to this particular surah. What is the cause of revelation? The cause of revelation, there are two narrations which we'll discuss at length later, bi-idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of that narrations is narrated on the authority of Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu. What does he say? He says, سَأَلَ أَهْلُ مَكَّةَ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمْ آيَةً فَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرُ بِمَكَّةَ فَنَزَلَتْ اِقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةُ وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرُ. That the people of Mecca, that is believers of Mecca, they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for a sign, a mu'jiza, a paranatural phenomenon that would indicate that his claim to prophethood is a true claim. So when they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for a sign, and then as the narration goes, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pointed to the moon, and the moon split into two. And this was the cause of revelation for this particular chapter, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. To end of this particular preamble to Surah Al-Qamar, we note that there are 55 verses, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best in Surah Al-Qamar. And today, inshallah, by the grace and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we seek to cover one or two of those verses, inshallah, bi-idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the chapter starts off in this particular manner. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بَعْدَ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ اِقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةُ وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرُ. The word اِقْتَرَبَ, the word اِقْتَرَبَ comes from the word, the root letters قَافْ رَا بَا. قَافْ رَا بَا means to be close. قَافْ رَا بَا means to be close. اِقْتَرَبَتْ, it is in the feminine form. السَّاعَةُ, As-sa'atu. The word as-sa'a, in the Arabic language, they divide things along these particular lines. They refer to the word as-sa'a. For those Arabic students, you would notice that it is not sa'atun, an hour, but rather it is as-sa'a. In other words, there's an alif lam at the beginning. Now, alif lam is for ta'rif, making something particular as opposed to being general. So as-sa'atu here is referred to as an alam. It is like a proper noun. Like you get a proper noun for Cape Town, the word as-sa'a is used as a proper noun. What does it refer to? It refers to that period in time when the world as we know it will come to an end. That is as-sa'a. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about it and says, اِقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةِ, that hour when the world as we know it will cease to exist, in other words, the world will come to an end, اِقْتَرَبَتْ, that particular hour is close. There's a unique understanding in terms of the closeness of it. What does it mean? One of our scholars, I don't recall his name now. If you give me a moment, I can get you the name. Ibn Atiyah, one of our scholars. You find, particularly nowadays, people estimate time in terms of how much time do we have left till that particular final hour. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here says that it is close. But what is meant by it is close? So some scholars, the proper explanation of iqtarabati sa'a, that the hour is close, it refers to that the time when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, the time before that, if you look at that particular time span, and look at the time span from after the Prophet ﷺ came, then what is meant by the hour is close is that the time remaining for the hour to come is less than the time that has passed since the beginning of creation. So that is what is meant, that the time has come close. In other words, it is near. The important thing is that Ibn Atiyah, nobody knows exactly when it is. When we talk about Musa alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala engages Musa alayhi salam in Surah Taha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ السَّاعَةَ لَآتِيَةٌ أَكَادُ أُخْفِيهَا. That indeed the hour, referring to when this war will come to an end. Indeed it is coming, it is definitely coming. When is it coming? We don't know. أَكَادُ أُخْفِيهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as if he's saying to us that if it was possible for me to conceal the information of the hour from myself, I would have concealed it from myself. In other words, in our colloquial terms, we would say it is the very best kept secret. Nobody knows it. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اِقَتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةَ, the hour is close. Like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, that بُعِثْتُ أَنَا وَالسَّاعَةَ هَتَيْنِ, that I was sent and the hour coming is like these two. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lifts up his index finger and he lifts up his middle finger. In other words, they are very close. They are close in the manner that we have explained. In other words, they're close in the manner that we explained. Less time remains for the hour to come than the time that has already passed. But that doesn't give us a license to guess in terms of when exactly the time is. And we find every now and then there's efforts from different quarters to actually put an amount to it, that there's 100 years left, 200, 300, 400, 500 years. That is not what is meant by the verse. All we need to know is that that time is close. We can't give it a time frame. It's close, but we can't give it a time frame. We can't put an exact time to it. And therefore, on one occasion, when the Prophet ﷺ was asked the question, مَتَ السَّاعَةَ, when is the hour? Is it something that you and I need to preoccupy ourselves with? When exactly is the hour going to take place? No. The Prophet ﷺ responded to this person by saying, مَا عَدَدْتَ لَهَا, what did you prepare for this hour? Don't concern yourself in terms of when the hour is going to happen. Concern yourself as to what have you prepared for this particular hour. We beseech Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the reality of the hour and then to enable us to practice in terms of preparing ourselves for that particular hour. So the surah starts off when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اِقَتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةِ, that the hour is close. Now, in relation to the cause of revelation, which we alluded to earlier on, and that was that the disbelievers of Makkah asked the Prophet ﷺ for a sign. And then the Prophet ﷺ pointed to the moon, and then the moon split asunder. There are two narrations in that particular regard. I'm going to start with the first one. The first one is recorded on the authority of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu. And we ran through the wording, and that wording is that they asked the Prophet ﷺ for a sign. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam pointed to the moon, then the moon split into two. So based on that particular narration, what had happened was based on the narration of Anas ibn Malik, what had happened was that the verse was first revealed and then the moon split. So first you had this verse, اِقَتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةُ وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرُ. The verse was revealed and then the moon was split. So then if you look closely, and this is an important thing, you know, in terms of us reading Quran, the idea is not only for us to basically sit in the Quran class, but the idea is for us to, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exhorts us to and says, أَفَلَا تَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ, you know, ponder about the Quran. So the idea is for us to read and ponder about the Quran. So when we look at the explanation and the version of Anas ibn Malik, what had happened was that the verse was first revealed and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the verse was first revealed, yes, and after the verse was revealed and then the moon had split. So now if you look at the verse now, and then the verse follows a particular order, اِقَتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةِ, that the hour has come near, and what has happened? The moon has split. So we see, based on Anas ibn Malik's explanation, then the verse runs in order. اِقَتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةِ, the hour is near, and وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرِ, and the moon has split. The other explanation, and that is given by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. According to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, according to his explanation of this occurrence, it says that First the moon split. First the moon split. And then the verse was revealed. So if the moon split first, and then the verse was revealed, and then the verse should have read, إِنْشَقَّ الْقَمَرْ وَقَتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةِ, that the moon had split, and that is a sign that the hour is close. That in other words, the day of judgment is close. So how is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned the verse around? How is it? And this is really what I would like to leave you with today. Because if we understand the verse in that particular regard, and then the message that comes across to us is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Quran, whenever the opportunity presents itself, whenever the opportunity presents itself to advise us, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to advise us. So now what happens is, what had happened was that the moon split. And the moon splitting is not a normal event. The moon splitting is a paranormal phenomenon. It doesn't happen every day. So when people witness this particular phenomenon, they come to a particular realization. Look, the world as we know it, this world as we know it, if the moon can split, then the world as we know it can come to an end. The sun can split, the celestial bodies as we know it, they can all come to an end. Now, when people are in this state of mind, when in this frame of mind, now it is the best opportunity to actually advise them, to give them advice. So after they had witnessed the moon splitting, because of the condition that they find themselves in, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as if he exploits this particular opportunity, and he uses opportunity to advise them, about what? Like the moon split. That is a sign that the world is going to come to an end. So prepare for that hour when the world is going to come to an end. So why is that unique for us? Normally, a class of this nature, we're conducting it in the masjid. Everything is as per normal. So, you know, you're taking time out of your otherwise busy schedule and you come into the mosque and you're having a class. But now, within the comfort of your home, you're actually accessing this particular class. Circumstances has changed. And under these changed circumstances, it is the outbreak of this particular pandemic that has forced us into a lockdown. We find ourselves in a circumstance which is different from our normal circumstances. It's almost like, just take yourself 1400 years back, with the disbelievers of Makkah, they weren't busy with their normal day-to-day routine. They were busy with it, but then a paranormal phenomenon happened. What happened? The moon had split. And this was a change of circumstances. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes this opportunity to remind them with a situation in their hearts are perhaps a bit softer, and those hardened hearts can be softened. Likewise, we find ourselves in a similar circumstances whereby our hearts are more prone to listen to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be softened by listening to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May it be such that, you know, when we're listening to these words in the situation that we find ourselves in, that our hearts are more susceptible to become softened to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala due to these unique and difficult circumstances that we find ourselves in. So this is one of the lessons that we take from the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts with this particular surah. The moon has split. Allah takes the opportunity to remind you of the year after, where you have to prepare, and which will ultimately end in a point where you stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah grant us the understanding. So I think by and large that would cover the first part of the verse, اِقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةُ وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرُ. And perhaps maybe for us to take out a moment when we look at the word انْشَقَّ الْقَمَرُ. We know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of the universe. And since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of the universe, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of the universe. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has control over everything. We know that, you know, the moon has an impact on the earth. Depending whether you have a full moon or whether you have a half a moon, that will basically affect. And something that we're all familiar with is like tides, it affects the tides. You know, when you have a full moon, then you have high tides and so forth. And the opposite also applies. Now, so the moon has an effect. So now, if the moon has an effect, you might ask yourself, look, but if the moon actually split, because when we talk about the splitting of the moon, what comes to mind? Splitting of the moon, literally we think that the moon is basically split in two, that the one half was on the one side, one half was on the other side. Some of the narrations go like that because there was two mountains. The one was Jabal Abu Qais, and the other one was, it's a bit of a difficult one to pronounce. So I'm not going to take up your time and look up that name again. Qu'ay-Pi'ad, that was the name of the other mountain. So you had half of the moon on the one side, half of the moon on the other side. So when we understand, we say the moon was split right in half and it happened. Now, if the full moon has any fix on the tide, you know, you and I might think to ourselves, if the moon is split and it's out of sync now, then what catastrophic impact must that not have had on the face of the earth? You know, if just the waning and the waxing of the moon and the movement of the moon in its normal orbit causes high tides, low tides, and all of those things. Now, my own understanding, Allah SWT knows best, is that Allah is the creator. If Allah wanted to split the moon apart physically and cause the one half of the moon to be on the one side, one half of the moon on the other side, and that didn't have a corollary impact on all the other orbits or all of the other creation, then Allah SWT has the power to do that, because the moon moving around orbit doesn't have an effect. Allah creates the moon, Allah creates the movement of the moon, and Allah SWT creates that effect of it. In other words, we believe in a phenomenon, a theory called, what some of our scholars, Mona Zakaria shared with me the other day, this phenomenon called occasionalism. Occasionalism means that you have, on every occasion, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who creates and recreates and brings things into effect. You know, for example, like you have a fire. Now does the fire burn? So on one occasion, if you take a piece of paper and you put it by the fire, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause the fire to burn that paper. But it is actually Allah who's causing the burning. But on another occasion, when they take Ibrahim alayhi salam and they throw him into the fire, then does he burn or he doesn't burn? On that occasion, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes the fire not to burn, which means that the fire doesn't burn within itself. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who does it. So for us to understand, wallahu a'lam, that the splitting of the moon was something which was like real, it is possible. Whether it actually happened in terms of the splitting of it, that's a different story altogether, because in terms of the evidence that we have in front of us, there's nothing which clearly tells us that there was a physical splitting of the moon. All it says was, inshaq al-qamar, that the moon split. How exactly the moon split and what is meant by it split, that is something which we will discuss very briefly now, bi-idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But before I want to discuss that, I had to first give that point in terms of our belief, wallahu a'lam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. When we look at some of the scholars and they say that the moon split, there's three explanations that Ibn Ashur presents. He says the one is that you had a major eclipse. So what happened with a major eclipse is that it caused a, in Arabic they call it a huwatun. It caused a raud, right? As a result of the eclipse, there was a road on the face of the moon. And let's refer to that road as, we have tar road, so it's a black. So in other words, black. So if that eclipse had that effect on the moon, and from the face of the earth, you are looking at the moon now, it appears as if the moon is in two, split in two. But in real terms, is that moon split into two? Not in real terms. That's one explanation which the scholars give. But now you might ask the question, but now, if the moon didn't really split, is it still a miracle? It still remains a miracle. Because when did this happen? This happened at the exact time, according to Anas ibn Malik, when the disbelievers of Makkah asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for a sign. And then when they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for a sign, and then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pointed out to the moon, and then the moon split. Even if it split in a manner that it was the consequence of a great eclipse, which you can almost like scientifically explain, it still remains a miracle, because for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to, they call it ilham in Arabic, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cause them to ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam this question at that particular time, and for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to respond in that particular manner, that's a miracle in and of itself. So it still remains a miracle in terms of this particular sun. Some of the scholars have a different take on it. They say that, you know, this like a solar eclipse and lunar eclipse, what happens? So for me to understand it very easily, what I do is I turn it around. So if you say solar eclipse, I say eclipse solar. Because what happens when you have a solar eclipse? What happens when you have a solar eclipse is that what do you have is you have the earth here and you have the sun here. Now in a solar eclipse or eclipse solar is that the moon comes in between, and then the moon prevents the rays of the sun to come to the earth. In other words, it eclipses the solar and the light doesn't come through, and therefore from if you're standing on the face of the earth and you're looking now, everything appears to be shadowed whilst you're in daylight. So lunar eclipse is a similar thing, but what happens with lunar then is that what happens with the, how is the eclipse of the lunar, how does it how does that happen? Then now I must think of it. The solar eclipse one was fairly easy for me to explain. Another lunar eclipse, what comes in between? So we're at night, right? So here's the Earth, right? And then you have the moon, right? But then what happens is the sun comes over the moon. The sun comes over the moon. In what sense? The sun comes. No, but that's almost a solar eclipse. So you know the I'm not an astronomer, so you might just get that proper, but it's one of the entities actually comes through and then the moon gets blocked out, the part of the moon what is supposed to shine doesn't shine anymore, and we know that the moon obviously is a reflection of the light of the sun. So my understanding would be then is that the Earth comes in between the, you know, the sun and the moon, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. So now what some of the scholars explained in this way, that actually what happened is between the sun and the moon, what happens is you find a tail, looking for a lunar eclipse. You find a celestial body. It comes in between the sun and the moon. Then that celestial body, it casts a shadow over the moon. Now that shadow that comes, it forms like a line over the moon. So now when we're looking from Earth again, what are we seeing? We're seeing that the moon appears to be split. But actually, what is it? It's a celestial body that comes in between, you know, the sun and the moon, and the shadow of that falls onto the moon, and then the moon appears to be split in half. That's another one of the explanation. Then there's another explanation. And Ibn Ashuri says that this explanation is like it happens in relation to the sun, like a solar eclipse, but it's also very seldom. But again, it's a plausible explanation. And what is that particular explanation? That what happened is, you know, when they saw the moon splitting, what happened? Half of the moon was on what were those two mountains again? Abu Qubais was the one mountain, and the other one had a unique spelling. Right? So when you look from the face of the earth, what did you see? You saw the moon split into two. How is it possible? So what happened was you had a partial eclipse of the moon, whereby, you know, what came in between the rays of the sun is now falling on the moon. So you only see half the moon, but the whole moon is actually there, but you only see half the moon. But that doesn't explain now how do you see the moon splitting, because now you must see the other half. So they explained that you had like a cloud-like formation, which was filled with water. And that half moon, it mirrored that half moon. And it reflected that mirrored image. And so it appeared that you had half the moon on the one side and half the moon on the other side. That's the other sort of scientific explanation that they give. Be it as it may, you know, whether you go with whatever explanation, at the end of the day, all of our ulama agree that what we witnessed there, in terms of iqtarabat as-sa'atu wa shaqqa al-qamar, that the moon had split. And this was a miracle of the miracles of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sallam. Some of our scholars, perhaps maybe those of us, some quote the splitting of the qamar to be something which is transmitted canonically, in other words, like a mutawatir, that nobody can deny it. The more correct view, according to Ibn Ashuri, says no, that this is a occurrence which was narrated by many companions, but not so many that it actually came to the level of tawatur. Tawatur means that so many people are narrating a particular incident that it's impossible for them to converge on a lie. It doesn't reach that level, but many, many, many of the companions have narrated this particular narration. Anas ibn Malik, you quoted, who else? Look at Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, in these Ibn Umar, Ali radiallahu anhu, Anas ibn Malik, you quoted, and other companions who narrate this. And then it is mentioned in the miracles of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. It is also mentioned in a certain genre of literature which is referred to as Dala'in Nubuwwah. You know, those that indicate upon to the signs of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. So this is, and you show one shaq al qamar, we find many anashid are made in terms of, you know, the qamar. And that is really celebrating this event, which indicates to the Prophethood of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So, اِقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةُ وَشَقَّ الْقَمَرُ. I think for us, if we leave all of those details behind, the thing which is most outstanding for me is the fact that if you look according to the explanation of Ibn Mas'ud, what had happened? The moon had split. It's a paranormal phenomenon happening. So what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? Allah exploits the opportunity to do what? To appeal to those hearts who are otherwise hardened, to appeal to those hearts with the hope that those hearts soften. And then we submit to the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and prepare ourselves for that time when we're going to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is really the most profound thing, and it relates to the condition that we find ourselves in, exactly, in Allah subhanahu knows best. So, اِقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةُ وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرُ وَإِيَّرَوْ آيَةً يُعْرِضُ وَيَكُولُ سِحْرٌ مُسْتَمِرٌ. And we go on now to the second verse of Surah Al-Qamar. How much time do we have left? 5 minutes. Okay, so we'll just read through the second verse, inshallah, and we end of the Ibn Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِن يَرَوْ آيَةً يُعْرِضُوا وَيَقُولُوا سِحْرٌ مُسْتَمِرٌ. وَإِن يَرَوْا آيَةً يُعْرِضُوا وَيَقُولُوا سِحْرٌ مُسْتَمِرٌ. وَإِن so now the word in, as we very well know, is in شَرْطِيَة. The word يَرَوْ is a present tense verb from رَآ يَرَى رُؤْيَة, which means to see. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is now talking about the disbelievers. Now, The fa'il of yarau is actually wawul jama'a there, but it's a pronoun. But then the surah just started, so the pronoun, which is a plural pronoun, who does it go back to? There's nothing in terms of the literary word that it goes back to. But we know that who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about? If they see, the whole setting and the context is that, according to some, the Prophet ﷺ was at Mina, and this was on the 14th night. You know, in other words, the last night they were spending at Mina. So they asked the Prophet ﷺ for a sign. All of the, you know, kingpins and the of Quraysh were there. Abu Jahl, Walid ibn al-Mughira, the two leaders of Aws al-Aswad was there, and many of the leaders were there. And they asked the Prophet ﷺ, and then the Prophet ﷺ pointed out to the moon, and the moon split into two. All of them were there. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Wa iyyaru," if they see, Allah's talking about those disbelievers. Or you can show them whatever sign, وَإِيَّرَوْ آيَةً, and if they see a sign, آيَةً. آيَةً is, if you look again in terms of the wording, it is nakira, it is مَعْرِفَ الْآيَةً, آيَةً. So then if you look at the context, for me just to go a bit slower then, وَإِن is in شَرْقِيَّة. The word يَرَوْ is a present tense verb, it means they see, and if they see. And then the next word is آيَةً, آيَةً means a sign. But now the word آيَةً is nakira, a sign. Now, when you have a nakira word coming after in shartiya, then it indicates to generality. In other words, any sign. That's why we translate it as any sign. وَإِن يَرَوْا آيَةً, if they see any sign. So Allah showed them a sign, and that was a great sign. What do they say? سِحْرٌ مُسْتَمِرٌ. What do they say? وَيَقُولُوا. They say, they respond by saying, they don't submit to the truth. This is a wondrous thing happening. It's out of the norm. There's definitely credibility to the claims which Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is making in terms of him being a prophet. That's what the supposed to be the outcome. But what do? They say sihrun, it is sihr. The word sihr, that's magic. It's sorcery. And what is the nature of this particular sorcery? Mustamir. And this is a unique word here because, and this also helps us to understand, you know, why we actually come to a tafsir class sometimes. Why do we come to a tafsir class? We can read the translation. But the word mustamir here, it comes from one of two root. It comes from the same root letters, mim and ra. Mustamir, that the meme seen is extra, and the ta is extra, and the meme and ra is the root letters. So the meme ra comes from marra yamurru means to pass, now it's come to an end. So let's say sihru mustamir, it is magic, what will happen to it? It will pass. Marra yamurru means to pass, so it's magic, it will pass. Don't set any store with it. It's, you can't use that event to substantiate the claims of Prophethood. No, that has come and has passed. So the word, the seen and the ta added to the word mim and ra is basically just to bolster the verb, but it means it will come past. Or the other explanation is that it comes from the word mirra. Mirra means to be strong. You know, this is strong sorcery. And we know, according to them, na'udhu billahi min dhalik, that the Prophet ﷺ is known for strong forms of sorcery. But it wasn't any strong form of sorcery. He had the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you signs when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appoints you as a messenger. So I think that would bring us to an end of our session today. Alhamdulillah, we've looked at Surah Al-Qamar, a brief introduction in terms of the name of the Surah, in terms of the names of the Surah, in terms of its revelation, in terms of its timeline, in terms of... we didn't look at the theme as such. We looked at the cause of revelation, alhamdulillah. And then we started off by explaining the first two verses. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants first and foremost me the understanding, and by extension, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants you all the understanding. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless and protect. Jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
إلا الله.